The more experienced I get, the more simple working with people seems to me. The essence of trauma, which is underneath all human dysfunction, addiction, affliction, disease, confusion, is separation from the self. And when people are manifesting behaviors or symptoms, that's what they're manifesting. So therefore, the essential intention of therapeutic interaction needs to be helping a person reconnect with themselves, knowing that as they do, their own innate wisdom will guide them in the right direction. How do we get people there? How do we get people to reconnect with themselves? Having lost it early in life, how do we regenerate or recover that connection? It's a process of inquiry, which I call compassionate inquiry. It begins with finding what's in the way of that connection. Because we were born, or at least conceived, and spent some months, or possibly even years, in the uterus, and afterwards, in some state of connection with ourselves. And then as the world's troubles pile onto us, we increasingly and gradually and imperceptibly disconnect. And then we suffer. So the first question in the process of compassionate inquiry is, how does that disconnection show up at this present moment? So when I'm working with people, whether in a group setting or an individual basis, I don't spend a lot of time with story about the past. The past is important only insofar as it illuminates what's happening in the present. Other than that, the past has no importance. So if I'm working with somebody, my intention is to, as quickly as possible, have them see how they're not connected to themselves at that moment. And so what I call compassionate inquiry to somebody from the outside may not seem compassionate, because I'm interrupting people and I'm asking them to stop and check in with themselves. And I will not make room for a lot of story and history telling. And that may seem uncompassionate, but I'm very convinced, and I have a teacher who puts it in these terms, that real compassion doesn't have to do with helping somebody feel good. It has to do with guiding them to the truth, because it's the truth that will liberate them. So the fundamental compassion has got nothing to do with how good somebody feels in a moment or how bad they feel at the moment. It has to do with, are they here being helped along to find the truth? Now, of course, the same teacher also says that only when compassion is present will people allow themselves to see the truth. But it's a fierce kind of compassion. So when I talk about compassionate inquiry, I'm talking about a fierce compassion that is not afraid to guide people to some painful places, not in the past, but in the present. So really, that's the first step. And not only is it the first step, it's also pretty much the only step necessary. Once people are capable of recognizing where they're being inauthentic, which is to say, disconnected from themselves, then the pathway is clear for the authenticity. So it's not so much a matter of working on being authentic, but it's a matter of patiently and fiercely, you might say, and compassionately inquiring into what's in the way of authenticity. It's a very interactive process. It's the very opposite of the stereotypical psychoanalyst who's sitting on a chair while the patient lies down, and with eyes closed, the patient just free associates. And the psychoanalyst with the Sigmund Freud beard and mustache and Viennese glasses sits there taking notes. It's actually being in the process with somebody moment to moment. So what the therapist, if you like to call the person therapist, brings to it is intense presence. Intense presence. So they can respond intuitively, not formulaically, but intuitively, whatever is happening at that moment. And from that state of presence, and that tapping into intuition, we then conduct the inquiry.